today are Diane Foley and Mr. and Mrs. Cassidy. Diane, thank you.
Thank you all for waiting in the hot sun. Goodness, so appreciate your attention. And today is the 8th anniversary of our son Jim's gruesome beheading by ISIS. But today we remember four extraordinary young Americans: Kayla Mueller, Peter Kasson, Stephen Sotloff, and our son Jim Foley. These brave Americans saw the suffering of the Syrian people and decided to help, whether it was by providing humanitarian aid or by telling the world about the tragic Syrian crisis. They've left a legacy of profound moral courage. I'm honored today to be joined by my friends Paula and Ed Kasich. Carla and Marcia Mueller will be joining us, and I'll be reading a small statement by Art and Shirley Sotloff, who were not able to be here due to illness. The James W. Foley Legacy Foundation welcomes this life sentence for Al-Shafi El-Sheikh. In order to deter violent crimes like international kidnapping and torture of American citizens, we must have accountability. We must have justice. And with today's verdict, we finally have a bit of justice. Let this sentencing make clear to all who dare to kidnap, torture, or kill any American citizen abroad that U.S. justice will find you wherever you are, and that our government will hold you accountable for your crimes against our citizens. On behalf of our family, I want to thank Judge Ellis, the FBI agents who pursued this case for 8 long years, and the outstanding attorneys, Dennis Fitzpatrick, Raj Parekh, John Gibbs, Alicia Cook, and Aidan Granos, and our wonderful victims assistant, Jennifer Donnarumma. Their pursuit of justice for these four Americans and their kindness to us has made a huge difference to us in our lives and represents really the very best of our U.S. justice system and our values as Americans. But as grateful as I am for this sentence, it is a hollow victory. Our country has lost four of his very best citizens. We families lost our loved ones forever. And now El-Sheikh and Cody, who have lost their freedom, country, and families. It's a tragic cycle of violence and heartbreak for all involved. This anniversary of Jim's brutal beheading is a solemn and tragic marker that no family should have to endure. But this continues. Currently, we have more than 67 of our U.S. nationals currently wrongfully detained, held hostage abroad, simply for being American. So I urgently call on our President Biden to employ our shrewdest negotiation to quickly bring these innocent Americans home, lest they die in captivity as our sons and daughter did. Let our country learn from our mistakes. The Foley Foundation was founded on the premise that the United States could do better to prioritize the return of its people held hostage abroad. There has been some progress. We do now have a hostage enterprise made into law by Robert Levinson's brave legacy. This was broadened and deepened recently by Biden's executive order, where he declared this a national emergency and an extraordinary threat to our national security. But the only true measure of our resolve as a country is to actually bring our people home. The 67 U.S. nationals are counting on you, President Biden, counting on our country. Let us insist that our U.S. passport mean that our government must and will help Americans who are targeted and held captive abroad. So with that, I'll turn to my fellow family members, and I'm happy to take questions afterwards. Thank you for your time. So appreciate you.
Diane, it is fitting that on this 8th anniversary of the loss of your Jim, that those responsible have been held accountable. This would not have happened without the efforts of countless people, both known and unknown to us. Ed and I want to take this opportunity to publicly thank them all. We extend special thanks to the released hostages who testified. They taught us a lot about what our son and the other hostages endured, and their testimony was essential in proving guilt. We thank all who participated. Thank you.
I think after the end of this long, arduous trial, we just need to thank the prosecution team for all the work they did, the time they put in to accomplish this. This is just one more step in the process. Marcia and I continue to search for Kayla. We continue to search for the truth about what happened to her because we don't know for sure. We want to bring her home. We want to put her on American soil where she belongs. I think it's probably good if I just take a few questions. Sometimes you get a lot more information if you answer questions that people may have. So I can take those if someone has one. Anyone have any questions?
What can be done to stop this?
Well, this is part of what could be done to stop this, is to see that these people are prosecuted, to track them down, which our government is doing right now. They continue to track these people down, and there's no tomorrow for them. They have to realize that if they commit this kind of a crime to American citizens, they will be tracked down and they will be prosecuted in an American court. That's what we've accomplished here today.
Giacomo from Rudal TV. Do you think this sentence is fair? Do you think the sentence is fair? The sentence to Shafi Akshat is fair?
Is fair?
Yeah.
Well, I do believe it's fair. As a lot of you may know, we had to take the death penalty off the table because of the British laws. So I think the punishment fits the crime in this case, absolutely. What he did to the Americans and all the other hostages, he will spend the rest of his days in a cell and have the time to consider what he's done. And it's a deterrent to others as well, not to do this kind of thing.
Did you say you continue to search for Kayla? What happened to her?
We do. We're working outside the government with private entities to try to find Kayla, try to find out exactly what happened to her. Of course, ISIS said it was a Jordanian bombing that killed her, and no one believes that. We don't believe that. So we're hoping that now, with the end of this trial, anyone, any place that knows anything about what happened to Kayla will come forward and let us know so we can bring her home.
For any of the family members, just in general, how you're feeling today? The trial has obviously gone on for quite a few days, so just, you know, how in general you're feeling now that it's been completed.
May I just read this statement from the Sotwalk family? Just before, we're happy to take questions.
I want to answer Amanda Pierce's question about
you know, we need to act right away. People put blinders on. They said that ISIS, or before ISIS, Al-Qaeda was done. We were done with terrorism. And then our people were taken. They didn't want to show that this had happened. That the government just kind of put blinders on and kept quiet and just kept telling us, we're doing everything we can. ISIS won't kill a woman. They just kept repeating these same lines to us instead of really doing anything and acting at the time. That's what I feel. The other thing I think that is important to say is we are deeply grateful to former Attorney General Bill Barr, who made the decision to get these men here to have this trial so that it can be a public thing, and that maybe that will help prevent things like this from happening again.
I just have a brief statement from Shirley and Art Sotloff I want to share. And then we'd be happy to take your questions, all of us. Shirley and Arthur say we're incredibly grateful to the United States government for making it possible to capture, to bring to our country, try and convict in a court of law the ISIS Beatles, who barbarically killed our beloved son, Stephen Sotloff, as well as the children of the other American families, including Kayla, Jim, and Peter. The breadth and scope of the work involved in reaching this point of life sentences should be commended. We hope that in some way, Stephen is looking down upon all of involved and saying thank you. So please come join me. We're happy to take questions, and I'm feeling some relief in answer to your question that this justice has been served too often when there's violence to our U.S. nationals in the world. There's no accountability. So this is a momentous day, and thanks to our Department of Justice, who has worked on this and continues to work on it to get answers. So we're incredibly grateful.
Step to the mic, please.
I was hoping he would speak, but I wasn't shocked that he didn't. He is going to appeal, or I think he might, so I'm not sure he didn't want to say anything.
Paul, what was your reaction?
I didn't expect him to speak. He's been just obviously cold with no remorse throughout the whole trial, and I still think he believes he was doing the right thing.
I agree with you, Carl. I really think that's why I had hoped he would speak, you know, but I think he just doesn't want to. He doesn't want to say he has any regret.
Would it have mattered if he spoke?
Pardon?
Would it have mattered if he spoke?
Would it have mattered? Well, yes, but, you know, he didn't want to. So that speaks volumes. Yeah.
In your opinion, do you believe the White House and State Department have learned their lessons in this case, and do you think they'll better respond to their families as possible in the future?
Well, I certainly hope so, because I totally agree with Marcia that these kind of incidents we have to take swift action. Right away, we have to do what it takes to locate a person in this situation, and then use deterrence and accountability right after. But to let these cases languish only make it all much more complex, and the chances of our people coming home much, much more complicated. Much, you know, great question.
I'm sure they've learned. The Obama administration left our daughter in Syria for 18 months. We had every opportunity to bring her home. They were negotiating with us. We were told if we paid a ransom, we could be prosecuted. They never asked us if we wanted to pay a ransom for our daughter. 18 months, she was tortured mentally, physically, chained, kept in solitary confinement, raped, and murdered. They definitely have learned their lesson, and our children was the cost of that. And hopefully in the future, our government will do like so many others did and get their people home, not leave them there for 18 months.
And that is what my huge concern is about our current U.S. nationals who are being held hostage. The average length of their detention is four and a half years. So, you know, the longer it goes on, I mean, Austin Tice marked his 10th anniversary, you know, as a political prisoner. Then it just gets more and more difficult, and of course a huge hardship for the victim and the family, and I pray that we're learning. I think we're starting to get the message, but you may have heard that some of the families are so impatient, they've started their own Bring Our Families Home campaign. They're so desperate because they don't feel they're being held in an urgent way.
What message do you have for the 67 families that are waiting to hear about the news of their loved ones? Do you have any words of encouragement for them?
Oh, absolutely. The Foley Foundation has their back. I mean, we agree that they have to make as much noise as they can, because there's so much going on in our country and our world now that it's very easy to, you know, not be heard. And in our cases, we were told repeatedly to be quiet, to not tell anybody, and I understand that, but it didn't serve us well at all, because it made this horrible crisis a silent one that everyone could ignore and did ignore.
I'd like to say something. Looking at the hostages that did get home, they're having families, they're married. Many came here and spoke at the trial. And I hope Daniel doesn't mind. I don't know if he's here, but one thing I will never forget him saying was he was the last hostage to get out when the rest of our families in the UK were left. And he said that John Cantley said to him, just tell them to bomb us. He was asking the government, the UK and the US government, to just bomb us. That would have been more mercy than what they were going through. That's something people need to remember.
In regards to your question, encouragement is that the FBI, it's changed dramatically since our children were taken. And because of the loss of our children, things are changing. And the government is pursuing this more desperately. We've met with Director Ray just not too long ago. And he told us both, we got this. We are not going to stop until we find Kayla. And I'm sure that the families that have loved ones being held right now, the FBI is on. And so that's the only encouragement I can give right now.
You were able to share this in court a little bit, but would you mind just sharing what you think your children would be saying on a momentous day like today? What they would want to share with us?
Well, I think Jim would have wanted our country to be proud that we did give El Sheikh and Cody a fair and humane trial, that they received defense attorneys and all that. I think, you know. But I think he would want to beseech our government to have the backs of brave Americans who must go out into the world, because we can't live in a bubble here. We need Americans out in the world as journalists, aid workers, educators, diplomats, And our government needs, our passport has to mean something. Our U.S. passport should mean that our government is with us and will protect us. And it's getting there. But as Marcia so wisely mentioned, it has to be a swifter reaction and followed by deterrence and much accountability to deter this horrible practice.
What was it like to have to spend so much time in the same room as this man?
Stressful. I spent most of the time staring at the back of his head, of course, but I don't know. I don't think there's any way I can explain the feeling of being in there with him. Just to know that he's getting what he deserves. And as far as our children, I would say, Kayla would be saying, Mom and Dad, just get on with your life. Have a normal life, which we can't do until we get her home. So that's what Kayla is saying.
Sorry. The one thing in Kayla's letter, she also told us, she said, I am doing everything I can on the inside. I will never give up. And we won't give up on getting her home. We truly are going to get Kayla home. That is so important to me and to her.
And on that note, I think it's very important that as a nation that we not give up on our innocent U.S. nationals who are taken hostage or wrongfully detained. That I will continue to beg for that to become a national priority. That just like other nations like France and Spain and Italy, prioritize the return of their citizens and their home. They were able to testify in court. And I feel our nation should similarly value the lives of our brave U.S. nationals.
And I would like to add to the, when you asked the question about seeing El Sheikh and Cody in the courtroom, who I was watching was prosecutors and the defense and Judge Ellis, and they did an amazing job on this trial. I can't say enough about all of them.
And they gave us a lot of strength, really. We were surrounded by the very best, and that's part of the tragic irony. You know, when we really needed our government to help us find our kids and then bring them home, we didn't have that support. We were shifted around and told our kids were a priority intellectually. But now that they, after their torture and brutal murder, now we receive the best of our country. And I'm very grateful, obviously, but that's what makes it a hollow victory, if you will.
Have any of you guys yet received the opportunity to meet or speak or get any answers from Cody? Has that occurred and have you learned anything?
Well, I did speak with him. I won't go into any of that. I think there's a lot. I mean, I probably shouldn't say much more about Cody, but yeah, we did speak with him.
Yeah, I think I met with him also 3 times, actually, twice in October and once recently. And I think that's important. Our brave kids would not have been afraid to meet him and see him. And I didn't want him to think we were afraid of him, even though it was rather intimidating. But I think it was good. I was able to share some of who Jim was, and he was able to share some of why he felt it was a war situation and his excuses. But he did articulate some remorse, and I was grateful for that.
One last question.
Marcia, what are the next steps for you as a family going forward, and would you seek to meet either
I did meet with Cody for about 2.5 hours. So I spoke to him at length, and I would meet him again. I hope to. El Sheikh doesn't have to meet with us. If he would, I would want him to. But my prayer all along in all of this was I've asked God to soften any hearts out there that know anything about any of this that would come forward and help us. And we are getting people helping us.
We're working with a wonderful private firm, the Savannah Center, and they have been just wonderful to us, helping us find things, working outside the government. You can get a lot more done a lot quicker. So we continue to work with them. They are working directly with the FBI, and we're moving forward. We really are, more so than we have in many years. The government's got their hands tied. You know, they have to go through a lot of protocol and a lot of red tape to do anything. Outside the government, you don't have to do that. And that's one thing I could mention for the families of the hostages that are still being held is if you can find some way to work outside the government, you'll get much more done in a very quick order. You know, it just works a lot better.
Yeah.